So I'm Raj, Raj Shekhar. I work as a developer evangelist for Microsoft. So this particular session is about So there is this. How many of you here have not heard of HTML5? So you know that's what I expected. Pretty much everybody has heard of HTML5, right? This is all this buzz around this new the new web, how you develop, how it's gonna change, how you're gonna develop web applications in the future. It's all about applications, and it's not just about serving content and whatnot. So this particular session, it's about is that really all hype, or is there something to it, or is that when we talk about HTML5, CSS3, ECMAScript5, are these things that we can use in our web applications today, right? Or can we not? Or if we can, how can we use them? So this is basically about, how we can build compatible web applications which give good user experiences given the state of the web as it is today, right? So very briefly, that's kind of the agenda. So we're kind of going to review, I don't know how visible this is at the end of the hall. But basically we're going to review, what are some of the challenges with building web applications that are that work across browsers and give a good user experience, and then we'll basically review some best practices around that, around building compatible web applications. So that's I'm sure how many of you here do web development for a living. So that's probably about 60% of the room, which is actually surprising. I would consider it more. And if I were to ask all you web developers, what is the single biggest pain point in your web development? I agree. So IE is a pretty big pain point. But I would probably generalize it as having to support so many browsers, right? You have to support IE, you have to support Firefox, Chrome, to a lesser extent probably Opera and Safari. But at least these big three you definitely have to support. And not only do you have to support all these different brands, but you end up having to support different versions within a brand, right? And of course, IE6, that's where all that pain is coming from. We have, still an acceptably large percentage of users who are on IE6, which is more than a decade old browser. So traditionally, what were some of the things that we were doing to, I forgot about this little. If you had to keep track of, feature metrics. I mean, that's what traditionally, the traditional approach to supporting different browsers. What browsers do we have? What features do they support? If I want to provide feature A in my web application, how do I make sure that this works across all these browsers? You have to pretty much figure out, like, IE version 6 with service pack N had support for this particular feature, and therefore I have a little code there which checks for that particular scenario, and then I enable that feature or disable that feature, or I provide a backfill or whatever the case is. If you want to do that, you probably need to be a superhero, right? That's what I was shooting for. So this kind of is the browser market share that I kind of put together yesterday from net market share. And you can see that IE8 has about 27%, Chrome about 15%, and so on and so forth. But you can see that there is no clear winner here, right? I can't say that I'll just support this one guy and I'm done, right? You can't say that. You pretty much have to it's a very fragmented market. For end users this is great news, right? If I'm an end user, I want to use the web. I'm just spoiled for choices, right? There are so many high quality browsers out there. But as web developers, not so much great news, right? So you have to worry about different browsers, different versions of each browser, and today the cadence at which new versions of browser being released is also increased tremendously. Probably precedence that's been set by Google with their, nobody really cares about the Chrome version. Who knows what is the current Chrome version? Yeah, I get like 20 different answers. So nobody knows and nobody cares. So, new versions of the browser are getting released continuously. It just makes our job worse and worse, right? If you have to keep track of versions and features, it's just impossible. You can't do it. So that's what something that we have been doing in the past. We detect browser versions. We detect browser brand, browser version, and we try to enable, disable features based on that. This is simply not going to happen. It can make grown people cry. So that's where feature detection comes into the picture, right? So going forward, you know, from a JavaScript point of view, right? How do you get, or how do you build in support for some of these newer HTML5 technologies, right? As we just saw, looking at versions and trying to map that to support for features is just not going to cut it, because there are just too many versions, too many browser brands. So Modernizer is basically a library that helps you deal with this. The basic idea is, don't make decisions based on browser versions, right? Check for basically try to detect programmatically whether a particular feature is available in the whatever the current browser is, right? Maybe you can check for the existence of a particular object or a method or a property or a particular behavior. You know, basically some kind of fingerprinting, you know, you have to do to figure out what is the current browser. And then dynamically, you know, you might, if it is a critical aspect of your site, you might want to dynamically load browsers or supplementary libraries which provide support for that particular feature which is there or which is not there. So, you know, typically you write code like this, right? So for example, here what I'm doing is, I'm saying navigator.userAgent.index of a particular substring. I'm basically looking at the user agent string of the current browser and seeing if it has a particular substring. If it does, then I do something, and if it doesn't, then I do something else. Basically here I'm making an assumption that a certain feature is going to be available based on a particular user agent. Basically here the code says that if it is IE, then do attach event. If it is not IE, then use add event listener, which is the HTML5 W3C standard way of attaching event handlers to events. So this is not a good idea. Do something like this instead. So here basically you can see that what we're doing is, we're checking whether the window object actually has a property method called add event listener. If it does, use it. If it doesn't, then I see if it has attach event, and if I have that, then I use it. If you have neither, then it's probably not a browser. So you know, I just wanted to quickly show you what that I mean, it's not exactly a very complicated demo or whatever. So you know, basically here so let me just show you the I guess that's not very visible, so I'll just open it here. So basically what's happening here is, you know, this is exactly what I showed you in the slide. I check if add event listener is available. If it is, then I you know, basically show this particular message, and if it is not, I show this message. It's not standard compliant. So you know, I go ahead and click that link. It says you're using a standard compliant browser because it went into that. I'll use IE's debugging tools to switch to so IE has this feature called as document mode, where you can switch the rendering mode, right? You can make it pretend like it is IE5 or IE7 or something like that. So I'll go into IE5 mode and click on it. So now it says it's not standards compliant and so on and so forth. But essentially what happened was, it went into the else case here and called attach event here, right? So a very simple example of how you might want to do feature detection. Now that was a very simple case, right? We said window dot attach add event listener. If it existed, then great, we use it. But what if feature detection looks like this? Now I know you can't read the code. That's kind of the idea. You know what? That's probably the reaction. No, that's where Modernizer comes to rescue, because what I showed you was a very simplistic case. You know, great. I mean, window dot. You know, everything is, you know, hunky dory, very fine. But you know, if you want to detect something that's slightly non-trivial. For example, that piece of code that you saw there was trying to detect whether the current browser has support for CSS3 font face rule, right? That's not quite as straightforward. So there is this nice library called Modernizer, which you know, now it's a very, you know, simple JavaScript API that you can use to detect support for all major HTML5 and CSS3 and even ECMAScript 5. You know, features, whether they're available in the current execution environment, in the current browser or not. So it detects all the major features. It includes HTML5 shims for semantic type older browsers. What I mean by that is, so with HTML5, one of the new things, right, as far as markup is concerned, is something called as semantic tags, right? Where basically your markup can be purely markup, right? There's no presentation information absolutely whatsoever in your markup. All presentation stuff goes into your style sheets, into your CSS, and your markup is just, you know, defining the structure of your document. You want to say that this is article, this is a section, this is a header, this is a footer, this is an aside, and so on and so forth. You are able to express or associate some semantic meaning to your marker. Turns out that up until IE8, you couldn't use these tags. Like, these are new tags, like article, section, aside, right? You couldn't just use that. I mean, you can use that, but you will not be able to style it. This was a problem up until IE8. IE9, of course, has support for all the new semantic tags and so on. But there is a certain workaround that you can use to make it in older versions of IE support these semantic tags. Basically, the actual hack doesn't matter. We have to just say document or create element of give a tag name, and then the tag name magically becomes styleable. So Modernizer has that little piece of pixie dust to make IE recognize all the new semantic tags, right? So if you use head section, section header footer and all, it will start working in automatically in older versions of browser, as long as you've included Modernizer. Modernizer is simply a JS, a JS file that you include in your page, and then you automatically get support for these tags, and you get support for feature detection. So for example, right, that gigantic piece of code that you saw, that's what it looks like when you use Modernizer. Way simpler, right? You simply say if modernizer.fontpage, then you do what you have to do. So pretty much all the features can be detected this way as a Boolean property. So say modernizer.canvas, modernizer.geolocation, modernizer.websockets, and so on and so forth. So let me quickly show you what that looks like. So here I have a little document. So I'll say allow blocked content. So first let me show you what that HTML has. So you can say it's a very simple HTML. I've used some of these semantic tags I was talking about. It has header, section, and blah blah blah, right? Some tags here. You will notice that right at the top I've included the Modernizer script. I've used 1.7 here. I put this demo together sometime back. Right now I think it's Modernizer version 2 has been released, so you can very well use the latest one. We have this markup here. You can see that there's no presentation information here. So that basically I put it inside my style sheet. So you know all the styling stuff over there. So you know this looks decent, right? Nicely styled and whatnot. So what I'll do is I'll go here and I'll take off this particular line. Maybe I'll just comment it out. Right, and I'll just use my debugging tools here to switch the document mode to let's say IE5 rendering mode, and you can see that that's what it looks like in IE5, right? It looks horrible, right? why does that happen? So basically, what the browser does in legacy, in IE6 and 8, is when it encounters a tag which it does not recognize, it's basically going to just treat it like just the text. It's just going to take the text and render it, right? It's not going to basically style it. So on the other hand, if I just bring this script back and I just refresh the page, it's still in IE5 rendering mode. It's not exactly pixel for pixel the same as what we saw earlier, but you can live with this, right? So basically what has happened here is all those tags, header, section, and so forth have become styleable. Now you can style those, right? And so Modernizer gives you this for free. What else can you do? For example, you can detect whether support for different features. For example, here I'm checking whether Canvas is supported in this particular browser, right? I check for that by saying modernizer.canvas. So that's the exact same syntax for pretty much all features that we want to detect. So that's great. So now we can do feature detection to see whether there's support for a particular HTML5 API in the current browser or not. Now, what do you do in case you encounter a situation where the browser does not support? You typically want to do more than alert, right? In my example, I'm just doing alert. So you want to provide that functionality, that feature. So how do you do that? So that's where polyfills and shims come into the picture. I know these sound like fancy terms, but essentially what these are is basically libraries that provide support for a particular HTML5 spec on a browser which does not natively provide that support. So let's quickly see what these are. So this is typically the scenario, right? So there is this nice new feature, maybe it's an HTML5 API that has been released. The latest versions of the browsers all support that. It's really nice. The geek in you wants to start using it, and you start using it. But then along comes the old browsers, right? Basically your users, end users. I mean, I don't know why people never upgrade their browsers, no? I mean, but they don't. I guess, it's just not something that end users will just go and do, right? Okay, today I'm going to go and upgrade my browser. Nobody does that. In fact, that's why it makes sense for the, you know, Firefox and Chrome, they update themselves. IE is going to start doing it very soon. I mean, it's been already announced. So browsers will start updating themselves. So these problems should eventually, you know, over time, hopefully go away. But right now, the reality is these problems are there. So when old browser comes along and your app goes thermonuclear, not good. So polyfills, what do? So they support new standards and make them work in older browsers, right? So polyfill stands for polymorphic backfilling, which is even more scary sounding, but no worry, it's a very simple concept. It's just a library, right? It's just typically a JavaScript library that provides support for an HTML5 style, for example, Canvas. Maybe, you know, I'm running on an old version of IE or Firefox, or I don't know if any version of Chrome did not have support for Canvas. And in that case, you want to provide support for that API in your app, right? So you can use a polyfill for that, a polyfill library for that. Some of the things you need to remember are, equivalent fidelity is not guaranteed. So the native implementation might work in a certain way. Polyfill might not give you the exact same experience. For example, typically, all these polyfills provide support for all these features using plugins, right? They might use Flash or they might use Silverlight to provide that equivalent functionality. And that means that the user has to install that plugin. Or maybe they don't have the correct version of the plugin, and it's a whole can of worms. That's why the world is actually kind of moving away from plugins, right? If you notice, Apple does not support plugins on their platforms, at least on their iOS platforms, right? You can't have Flash. On Windows 8, you'll find that, you know, on the Metro side of things, the Metro version of Internet Explorer does not support plugins, does not support Flash, does not support SQLite, just, you know, HTML, that's it. So the reason is, it's just not a good user experience. The user does not have the plugin information, but does not have the correct version of the plugin. You know, that's a pain point, right? So that's something you have to remember with polyfills. You get to use and leverage new specs without losing, you know, an entire chunk of user base who are not on the correct version of the browser. An equivalent kind of concept is a shim. A shim is basically just a regular library. It's different from a polyfill in that a polyfill typically will implement a W3C spec, a standard. For example, it will implement the Canvas API, it will implement the geolocation API. That's called a polyfill. A shim is basically a library, just a regular library, that's all, right? Nothing fancy. Typically what these libraries will do is they will be an abstraction on top of some functionality that's provided by the HTML5 specification. For example, there is this library called as Amplify Stone, which is basically an API that has been built on top of all the available client-side storage technologies, starting with cookies, right? Cookies, DOM storage, IndexedDB, maybe storage through local storage through Flash or SQLite. So Amplify Store is a high-level API which you can use to get the ability to store data on the client side, and its implementation takes care of using the most appropriate technology, whatever is available. On a modern browser, it might use IndexedDB. Right? On an older browser, it might use cookies. I don't know. Right? So that's called as a shim. So just some terminologies. So the folks who build Modernizer, the library, they maintain a gigantic list of polyfills in that location. You can just go to bit.ly/polyfills. I don't know if the network works here. I can show you. Yep, well enough. So this is basically the page. So here they have classified it based on the technology area. SVG, Canvas, Web Storage, and so on and so forth. There's a big list of polyfills that are available. It's a very useful list. But just like, you know, any open source libraries that you might use in your applications, remember that you'll probably have to vet the code. Somebody else has written it, they don't owe you anything, so you'll have to vet the code and make sure that it works for you. And you may have to support it in the future as well, right? But otherwise, that's one way that you can deal with this whole browser fragmentation problem. So one demo that I'm going to kind of show you with this is, so I've put together a little app here. So basically this is a HTML5 doodler. So this little gray area that you see is basically a canvas where I can go and draw stuff. So I can just do that. And this is not any plugin or anything, so I'm not using Flash, Silverlight. So you know, that's great, right? So this is working well. But then I'm on i10 here. So what happens if I go and go into Internet Explorer 5 works mode? So basically now I'm simulating IE5. IE5 definitely does not support Canvas, but you can see that I'm still able to draw, right? So how does this work? The only thing is, if I right click, this is actually using Silverlight. But to the end user, there is no difference, right? Whether I'm using IE9, IE10, Firefox, Chrome, IE5, IE6, I get the same experience. So how is this enabled? So in this particular app, I used a Canvas polyfill that I got from GitHub, right? That URL that I showed you. So I downloaded a polyfill for Canvas and I implemented it. So very briefly, if you want to see the code, how it figures out stuff. So I've actually used Modernizer for this. So this is slightly non-trivial here. So for example, code like this. So here what I do is, if Modernizer.canvas is true, which means it's available, then I do something, and otherwise I basically enable the. So basically, in the markup, if you see, I have both. So right down here, I have the canvas tag here, which is where the rendering happens, and right below that I have an object tag here to instantiate my Silverlight plugin, and then there's a little bit of script up here, figures out which will be displayed. Right, it checks whether canvas is available. Canvas available is great. If it's not available, then it uses that. Now the nice thing about using a polyfill is that the code that actually does the drawing. So for example, this is the script which there's a fair bit of stuff here. But let me just show you the core code that draws lines, right? So this is the function that actually is drawing those doodles, right? So here you can see that all we are doing is there is this. This is basically the Canvas API, right? I set the line color. I do a begin path, and then I do move to line 2, and then I do a stroke, right? So this is the API, this is the W3C Canvas API, right? Now the nice thing is, regardless of what I'm using, whether I'm using the Silverlight plugin or whether I'm using the regular native Canvas implementation, this code doesn't change for me, right? So this is a very simple implementation, but take a case where I'm doing like lots of complex stuff, right? If I had to use different APIs and different code paths, that just exponentially increases your test area, test surface, and it just gets more complicated. Whereas here, I just write this code once and it just works everywhere. So that's what polyfills give you. So obviously there'll be a little bit of hookup code elsewhere. So for example, when I so basically here in drawline I use this.dc, right? So that this.dc will get conditionally initialized depending on whether support for Canvas is there or not. That should be happening somewhere here. So you can see that I've written a little wrapper around all that. So there is get canvas here. So if modernizer or canvas exists, then I simply get the canvas object and return that object. If canvas is not supported, then I basically go and I'm doing a redundant check here, that's not required. If canvas is not supported, I simply get a reference to the Silverlight instance and return that, right? The nice thing is, that's all. So this is the only piece of code where I'm doing some feature detection and doing some alternate code paths are existing. The rest of my logic completely does not change. So that's the idea behind using polyfills. So you automatically get Silverlight. But obviously here, this is a good path, this is a happy path. If the user didn't have Silverlight, obviously you'd have complications. Alright, so with that I'm kind of done. How much time do we have?
We have about 10 minutes, I suppose.
We have about 10 minutes.
Sorry, 8 minutes, I guess.
Hey, how did we go here now? Alright, so another example that I want to talk about was about HTML5 video. We can either do that, or if you have questions, we can talk about that. Okay. Talk about video. Yes.
Do you use polyfill? Okay. Use polyfill. Do you really need to use modernizer as well?
You need to what? Sorry.
Modernizer as well.
Modernizer. No, modernizer is.
I guess the polyfill itself takes care of modernizer code as well. in the code it's written.
It's not. Just push it up. Yeah.
Okay. What I think is, if you use polyfill level, we then take the model input as well, like this. Is that our field expert explicitly import modelizer and go through the kind of yes, canvas, so on, all this stuff? Do you see that?
Well, see, the polyfill libraries are just open source volunteer, right? Different people are putting it together. Somebody says, I want to support, we can't use an older browser, they just put it together. So, modernizer is a completely separate initiative. I think somebody from Google is the person who is there. It's on GitHub, you can look at the modernizer source code, everything. So, that's a completely different initiative, right? So, we can use modernizer to do feature detection, and then, which other polyfill we want to use. So, we might have a preference for one particular implementation of Canvas. Here I use Silverlight, maybe you use a Flash-based one, and so on and so forth. So, those are...
My question is, if you use polyfill, the thing I'm guessing is, the process to support the Canvas, polyfill will take care of the process Canvas. If
right.
not, it will take care of the using the polyfill Canvas.
Depends on the API. So, for example, right, let's say you're using geolocation.
Okay.
Now, there we could definitely do something like that. Right? Whereas something with Canvas, it's slightly different. So in my case, I have to put a Canvas tag and a Silverlight tag there. Depends on the polyfill in question. There might be a polyfill which provides a better interface where I can kind of abstract away whether I'm using a polyfill or not.
Okay.
There might be other polyfills which don't. Any other questions? Questions. So we'll probably talk about video. The only reason I didn't kind of want to talk about video is it's not very related to, it has nothing to do with JavaScript. So far what we saw, we talked, look at JavaScript APIs, which are JavaScript HTML5 APIs, for which we have polyfills that you can use and modernize the library, the Azure feature detection and whatnot. HTML5 video is another HTML5 feature, right? So now you don't need plugins to play video in your web applications. Do you have a question? Yes.
Could you use the mic, please? There should be one there.
Can you talk a little bit on the JavaScript platform that Windows is going to provide on Windows 8?
On i10, you mean?
Yeah. Because what kind of platform is going to be?
As in, is there anything specific they want to know? It's going to be a completely ES5 compliant
JavaScript
engine, yes.
Will have a DOM or something?
Yeah, of course. I mean, IE9's ES5 implementation is one of the most standard compliant implementations ever. So, what you can do is you can go to ES5, ECMA, ECMA International site. There's a test suite for ECMA Script 5. Go ahead and run it on all the browsers. So IE9 already has support for ES5. I don't know what new things are coming in the JavaScript engine in IE10. Probably performance improvements, I don't know. Yeah.
On the same thread, Windows 8, when I started using it, the DOM object structure seemed to be very different. For example, when I tried to use the inner archive, the styles weren't applying. The styles weren't applying.
Okay.
The document object model. So, Windows 8 document object model is different from that of IE9, as you mentioned. It seems to me when I tried to use it, that as though it's compiled, it's not an interpreted JavaScript which happens in a regular IE9.
Mm-hmm. IE9 is not interpreted either. So from IE9 onwards, the JavaScript engine is a different architecture. Up until IE8, it's a purely interpreter-based JavaScript runtime. With IE9 onwards, it has like a dual code path. So basically, there is this little instrumentation that happens as your application is running, where it tries to identify hot paths in your JavaScript code. Hot paths are basically sequences of script which are getting executed often, frequently, and so on. And those pieces of script get compiled into native, and then once they get compiled, they run as native code. So it's like kind of like hybrid of what Chrome does and what Firefox does. So that's going to continue in IE10 as well. As far as DOM the goal is for it to be, you know, as compliant to the W3C HTML5 standards as it can be. So if you're seeing a certain behavior,
it sounded more like a titanium kind of a compilation into an Objective-C rather than a native JavaScript which modified.
What makes you say that?
Because I wasn't able to get the same behavior which I would have done while trying to use an IE9 which modified the document of the model. It didn't happen that way when I started using Windows.
I mean, I don't know. The particular use case you're talking about, we can probably, you know, discuss that offline. But the basic interface and everything remains exactly the same. If anything, IE10 is going to be supporting, you know, even more of the HTML5 spec, more of the standards, support for web sockets, IndexedDB, you know, more of what was not there in IE9 is going to be there in IE10. So, do we have time to talk about video?
Let's see.
It's 12:30.
Yeah, we have time.
About
10 minutes.
All right. So, with HTML5, right? So video was probably one of the most visible parts of HTML5 with the new spec, right? So that's typically how you did video before, right? You use plugins. I mean, that was pretty much the only option. You use Flash Silverlight. So this is the new way of doing it with HTML5. You know it's much cleaner and it's natively supported. So all that goodness comes. You know, basically just a video tag. You set up a source and then it starts playing. Unfortunately, it's not, you know, as ideal as it could have been. There is the codec sob story, right? I mean, this was a great opportunity for creating a standard which everybody implemented. Unfortunately, it did not happen. So what is the reality? The reality is there are different codecs. The codecs are basically the piece of code that decode and encode video or any kind of media, right? Or sound, video, and so on. So obviously when we're talking about browsers, we're talking about decoding. Different people have different ideas about which are the correct codecs to support, right? That's the issue. There is no standard, or there are too many standards, right? There was this funny XKCD cartoon that I saw some time back, right? So somebody says, no, for this particular piece of technology, we have all these technologies, right? There is no uniformity, there is no standard. So I'm going to create a new one, which is going to uniform, you know, make up this one. And that becomes the next item in that list. So that's essentially what happened here also. So you have IE5 Fox and so on and so forth. This is basically a matrix that talks about what is the codec support. So there are three main codecs. So we have Theora in the all container. You have H.264 video codec in MP4. And you have WebM. So basically the situation is, at least for the IE, Firefox and Chrome. Chrome supports Theora and WebM. Safari supports H.264, IE supports H.264 and kind of supports WebM. Firefox supports Theora and WebM. Right, so I mean this again, just like our browser fragmentation story, no clear winner. The story between IE and Chrome is a little funny. So see here in this diagram it says H.264 itself dot. I mean, it's not supported, but that's not quite true. What happened was, basically Microsoft and Apple, they think H.264 is the way to go. Chrome believes WebM is the way to go. They're worried about royalty issues with H.264. Safari, obviously, you know, Theora is completely free, open source, royalty, you know, no encumbrance with royalties. So the funny thing is, IE supports WebM. So IE is not going to ship with support for WebM. Right, but Google has put together a codec for IE. So if that codec is installed on the machine, then IE will play HTML5 video, which uses WebM encoded video. And the funny thing was, Google Chrome have threatened not to support H.264. So far, they have not actually done it. They have not removed support for H.264 yet. They might. So for that, Microsoft has put together an add-in for Google Chrome. So if that's installed, H.264 will work there. But you know what, that's not an ideal situation, right? The whole idea with HTML5 is to move away from plugins, move away from having to install stuff on the client side. But you know, with video, that's unfortunately not the case. So what does that mean for us, right? If you want to put video content on your web application, and yeah, I didn't even talk about the mobile side of things. Mobile side of things is slightly better. In general, but here also you can see that there are differences. So IE9, the same metrics you will see on the Windows Phone side as well. Android and iOS both have support for H.264, so maybe it's slightly better there. So you know that's what we have to do. We have to support everybody, right? So fortunately, the HTML5 tags is kind of, you know, I think they had that far view to support this. So you can do this. You can have a video tag and have multiple source tags, each one a different encoding, and the browser will just pick whatever is the one that it supports, right? But what about old browsers, right? What about IE6 and 8? They don't support video tag. So you can fall back to Silverlight or Flash. So, you know, this is kind of funny, like how many levels of fallback we have here, right? We have video tag, but then the encoding might not be supported. So we have to fall back to that for multiple encoding, but then video tag might not be supported. So we go to Flash, and you know what, you can go to even more. Maybe the Flash is not supported, so you do Silverlight. Maybe Silverlight is not supported, now you can put some text there, right? That's the fallback. You can go for object tag also. You can say, you know, go get a better browser. You can put that message there. So let me show you what that looks like. So you know, here is a simple video. So this little waterfall, it plays the waterfall, very pretty. Let's open that here and see what that looks like. So very simple, right? So I have not used the source tag. If you have just one video, you can put it as an attribute to the video tag as well. So it just takes it and plays it. So let's see what happens if I take that and load it in Firefox. So this is Firefox. I don't know what version I have. See, now I don't know what file. Okay, 10. So 10 definitely supports video, right? Firefox supported video tag for a very long time, but it's not able to play it. Why it is not able to play? Because it's an MP4. It's a H.264 encoded video. So let's try opening video 2.html here. And obviously, it's able to play here. So what is video 2? Let's take a look at video 2. So it's essentially what I showed in the slide. So I have both now. So I have MP4 as well as OGV on video, and it's able to play, you know, both of them just fine. Now let's go back to IE here and go to works mode, and you can see that doesn't look like a video to me. So let's open this. So right now I'm still in works mode. It's in IE5, and you can see that it's able to play. And if I switch to standards mode again, I mean, that also plays, right? So what is the black magic here? So yeah, so we have video, we have multiple sources for supporting Firefox and IE, and then we have object tag for yeah. I mean, don't be worried about that. I mean, I just happen to use a very complicated video player, but there are simpler ones out there. But anyway, so. You know, that's the situation with video as far as supporting, you know, all the different browsers are concerned. So that's just some, you know, kind of hope you had some idea about how what it takes to, you know, support different browsers for all the modern HTML5 APIs. So that's my blog, email, Twitter. You can get in touch with me through those. Here are some books that I thought are really, really nice. HTML5 Web Designers is in particular a really nice book. You know what's the nicest thing about that book? It's only 80 pages. Very small book. So you can read it in one evening. But then it's a nice book because it really gives you a good picture of what the, you know, what is the hype around this whole technology. What can you do to start using these today? Even the same thing with the CSS3 for web designers. What I really liked about that book is it talks about CSS3 and what pieces of CSS3 can you use today, and gives you some best practices around that. Right? Because ultimately your clients want you to support everybody, right? So you know what, I read a little blog post recently. So you go and ask your client, do you want this app to support IE6 or IE7? What do you think the client will tell you?
Yes.
Yes, of course, it has to support IE6. You know what you should do in response? You should add one more item to your bill, support for IE6, and put a big amount there. No, seriously, because that's what it takes, right? So putting a 10-year-old browser is going to take a lot of effort from your side, right? transmit that cost to the client, right? So that will be a little motivation for people to upgrade, get their user base to upgrade, right? So actually, I thought that was pretty good.
When 10 comes, can't you kill 6 and automatically upgrade to 10?
Yes. So that's going to happen. So from the subsequent Windows update, all users of IE6 are going to, depending on your operating system, XP users are going to go to IE8, Windows Vista and up are going to go to 9, Windows 7, whenever IE10 comes out, then it's going to upgrade to 10, and so on and so forth. So maybe a couple of years down the line, this will be less of an issue, hopefully. So we can all go into other things, better things. So that's it. I'm done with my session. I think we still have
no time.
No time. Okay. Awesome. Thank you.